So what's new? What give us the big update, first of all?
Well, I would argue of all the causes that people are spending their time with, countless causes that are valid in and of themselves, George, against the backdrop of a collapsing climate system and a collapsing biosphere, and I realize how many people will roll their eyes and walk away at that statement, because it's simply something that none of us want to believe is happening. But I would ask everybody to abandon ideology, preconception, and bias. Look at frontline facts. This is not a political issue. This is about life on our planet. And in regard to any political side of the fence or environmental groups, all of whom are ignoring this issue, immense hypocrisy. The bottom line is it's happening, and anybody who does any honest, objective investigation, George, will come to that conclusion. On the current course, we're not going to be around long. None of us.
And it's happening. Why? Is there money involved here, Dane? What's fueling this?
This is important. It's an important question, because many people have convinced themselves that if bad things are going on, it's just a matter of money, and that's the bottom line. But it's not the bottom line. And somehow people think if someone's making money on it, maybe it's not even happening at all. And that's certainly not true. And I would point out wars, George. We all know people make money off of wars, don't we?
They sure do.
Does that mean the war didn't happen? Or the people didn't die? Doesn't mean that. So in regard to the collapsing climate, yes, we have disaster capitalists all over the board. But that doesn't mean the disaster is not real. And that every attempt to, in fact, the attempt to make money off of it, which is certainly going on. Climate engineering, I would argue, is perhaps the largest covert money-making venture for the defense industry. And much of even the airline industry, which we believe data indicates is being fully subsidized to keep their aircraft in the air, because their aircraft are also being used in these programs. We know that. We're not guessing. We have up-close photographs of the nozzles mounted on the pylons of commercial carriers. Your listeners can look at all these photographs at geoengineeringwatch.org. They're mounted on the pylons aiming to the exhaust jet stream to make this look like condensation. So there's money being made everywhere in this situation. And we have too many people that, in exchange for a paycheck and a pension, George, will continue to help sink the ship with programs that are simply, ultimately, a matter of power and control. It's not for the greater good overall. Absolutely not.
Dane, the skeptics, if they come up to you and say, come on now, where's the proof? Show us what's happening. Prove it. How do you combat that?
Well, to start with, George, if people don't believe what they can see with their own eyes, likely not much I can tell them. It's hard to wake someone who's pretending to be asleep, isn't it?
That's right.
So if people can't, with any sense of deductive reasoning, look up and question why one day's a grid pattern, the next day's nothing with similar atmospheric conditions, why one trail can be horizon to horizon with an aircraft next to it, similar altitude, leaving nothing, why a trail that's coming across the entire sky just turns off like it's been cut with a knife, why you might have a whole day of spraying at a nighttime, and there is spraying going on at night as well, but it more often than not, we will see a backing off of the aerosol operations at night in their attempt to allow some of the radiant heat to escape back up in the upper atmosphere. And George, for those, might I explain for your listeners that don't know what climate engineering, geoengineering is?
Sure, go ahead.
Okay. Quite simply, it's the attempt to manipulate Earth's climate systems. The stated purpose, primary stated purpose, solar radiation management, to try to reduce some of the sun's incoming thermal energy to mitigate the warming that's occurring from a buildup of greenhouse gases. But George, as you know, when you put a reflective layer of aerosols up, you not only reflect, you trap it.
That's right.
Exactly. And you do a long list of other very cataclysmic consequences also.
You create what you're apparently trying to prevent.
Correct. And then bottom line with geoengineering, they can and are creating short-term, highly toxic cool-down regions at the cost of a worsened overall warming. And George, don't we have the pharmaceutical... I cite this example a lot because people relate to this. How many pharmaceutical commercials do you see every single day on the TV?
Well, they're all over the place.
So you take this new pharmaceutical for a certain ailment, and then you start to listen to the list of consequences.
Right at the end, that they give so fast, you can barely understand them.
But the list is so horrific that you can't imagine why anybody would allow themselves to be a test subject.
If you take this pill, your arms will fall off, your toes will fall off, and your eyes may. I mean, it's just unbelievable stuff.
But yet people are buying into this. They continue to take these elements. And certainly, if one really stands back and looks at the wider picture, I would argue that it's hard not to conclude we're living in a Orwellian insane asylum where black is white, up is down, day is night. You know, every other commercial now is asthma, allergy, Alzheimer's, as if that's something you can expect to get as you get older, dementia, a host of other issues. And again, the toxic, we're back to the toxic heavy metals that official agencies are telling us are not harmful for us, from vaccinations to what's raining down through the air column. For your listeners that don't know, heavy metals like aluminum are a primary element named in climate engineering patents. And we know these elements are coming down through the rain or the air column. We're testing precipitation. And we've got 70 lab tests from Northern California. We have lab tests from all over the country and indeed all over the world. We know these elements are coming down through the air column. In the case of our location in California, we know they're not coming from Asia. That's what a lot of people leap to first. We have California air quality studies to prove that. And they're such immense quantities, and the quantities are recent, so much so that it's changing soil pH values in Northern California. So this is an immense contamination. Mathematically speaking, the single greatest source of toxic atmospheric particulates, bar none.
Dane, what got you involved in this? Was there something that happened to you?
Yes, I was losing solar power. As you announced on my bio, I'm completely off-grid, solar, wind, and hydro. So when I began to lose very extreme amounts on some days of my solar PV uptake, 60, 70, even 80%.
Jeez, huge.
Exactly. From whatever the aircraft were emitting, clearly that was not condensation. And, of course, as I dove into research on this and was astounded that the volumes of data that were available on geoengineering, climate engineering, solar radiation management, cloud albedo enhancement, these are all climate engineering terms, which, by the way, in this issue, it's extremely important to use those terms. Thank you for doing so, because that gives our issue credibility. The chemtrails term, for your listeners that don't know, has no basis in science whatsoever. Those who argue that it does, because Dennis Kucinich mentioned it once, that does not give it a basis in science. And that term is used to marginalize our issue. So those are the science terms I just used as I was losing this much power. Again, finding the data I found, researching the patents, looking for the primary elements, testing my precipitation, finding those elements that were escalating at truly alarming rates. And after enough research, George, there's simply nothing else one could conclude. And when you know this is going on above you, there's nowhere to hide. What does one do, George, but turn and fight and face this
right.
issue?
And they had no idea what they created with you, do they? They do now, probably.
Well, you know, we know we're making a difference. We had earlier tonight, in fact, on a conference call with our attorneys. We have a legal team. We filed a lawsuit in Canada. We've already filed in the U.S. We've sued the Department of Commerce because they're overseeing agency for NOAA, National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration.
Okay.
On our call tonight, we had three high-ranking former U.S. Air Force officers, two major generals, on our call tonight, all of whom are extremely alarmed at these programs, also not directly involved.
Are these going to be witnesses for you?
No, I can't say that yet. They're not willing to go there yet.
They're not on board yet.
Well, they're certainly on board with the cause, but they're not quite ready to throw themselves under the bus yet. But they are helping us behind the scenes. We have others in D.C., former Senate Armed Services Committee.
They're scared about their pensions and things, aren't they?
Well, I think more than that, much more than that.
Really? Like their life?
Well, let's look at, we have in 2011, John Wheeler, former Bush aide, was reportedly seen outside the Pentagon stating he was going to expose this issue. He was found in a landfill 2 days later. 2015, we had three prominent polar scientists, certainly in a position to know this was going on, all died very anomalous deaths. We had the world's most recognized polar scientist, Peter Weddems, state that he felt that they were taken out. Didn't say why, but he felt that that's what happened. He recanted 2 weeks later, perhaps warned. We had a chief modeling specialist at the Weather Channel, certainly the one in position to know that the weather modeling is all being done by Raytheon. Defense contractor Raytheon, who holds numerous climate engineering patents, certainly a part of the climate engineering operations. He was suicided in the Weather Channel garage. Very anomalous death.
Mm.
According to friends and family, would have never done that. So, George, if we have an issue that's so immense, with such incalculable liability, and given that this is going on with governments around the globe, not just ours. They're all colluding and cooperating on this issue. Why would we not conclude that the government would do anything in its power to keep this from coming to light? Because the liability issues are completely incalculable.
Now, are we sure, Dane, this is being done on a governmental-wide plan? Or what if it's a private sector, you know, under-the-table black ops program that government doesn't even know is going on?
Not even remotely possible.
You don't think so?
It's impossible. You couldn't have operations like this going on without DOD knowing.
Okay, so they know. Somebody knows.
Knowing. We have foreign governments, in the case of Iran, stating on the record, Iran has sophisticated radar and military equipment. They know what's going on in their skies. They've been on the floor of the UN stating on the record NATO weather modification programs are cutting off their rain. So when we look at this, George, as the stated purpose that sounds benevolent, solar radiation management, we're going to try to keep the planet from cooking, although we know interfering with the natural systems is completely cataclysmic. It's a leap off the cliff, nothing less. But also, weather is being used as a weapon, and this is historical fact. We know from Project Popeye to a number of other weather mod activities that weather has been used for a weapon for 70-plus years. The notion that this could be done without governmental knowledge or full cooperation, in fact, full organization, is simply not plausible at all. And we know that military planes are spraying. We have film footage of it. We have photographs of the nozzles, KC-10s, KC-135s, C-17s. There's absolutely no question that the U.S. DOD is at the heart of this. Now, George, a couple of facts and figures on the climate, to tie it into climate engineering, if I may. Who has the biggest military in the world, George, by far?
We do.
Of course. It's
hands down.
It's bigger than the next 10 militaries combined. So we just had, on planet Earth, the third warmest April ever recorded on the planet, and I would argue that's conservative based on the figures we have on the ground. And for your listeners to think this is about Al Gore, it's not. Al Gore is a criminal, part of the power structure. This is about reality. But, George, at the same exact time, and I just did a post on this, your listeners can look at it, geoengineeringwatch.org, the eastern half of the U.S., the most populated portion of the U.S., just had the coldest winter in 20 years. And on the entire global map, and the maps I posted are the departure from normal temperature maps for the entire world. And what do we see on those maps for the month of April? A red world, which means, you know, there's different shades of red, which show the different shades of departure from normal temperature, but right. All red. Where's the only blue zone on the planet? The eastern half of the North American continent. Then I post a map for the entire last year, April 2017 through April 2018. Where's the only blue zone on the entire map?
Same location, right?
Same location. This is not an accident. The biggest military is capable of cooling what they want more than other militaries with patented processes of chemical ice nucleation. For your listeners that don't know what that is, those are patented processes. We have the patents posted at Geoengineering Watch, by the way. That
are these tests, Dane, or are they good to go?
They've been at this for 70 years, George.
Oh, that's not a test.
Historical data proves it. So what the nucleation is, means they can engineer winter events. It means they can turn what should have been rain into snow with seeding clouds, with chemical ice nucleation elements. George, have you seen a lot of the extremely radical weather whiplash scenarios that are happening?
Oh, my God, it doesn't stop.
Where you go from maybe 100 degrees to
60
in a day or two. Or
yeah.
So we're seeing that, and this is a cold, dense layer of air, maybe a few hundred feet deep or maybe slightly larger. But as you create this cold, dense layer of air by seeding clouds with chemical ice nucleation elements, that descends down to surface levels, lowers the mercury on the ground, can create, again, frozen precipitation out of what should have been liquid precipitation. And thus, these anomalous weather whiplash scenarios come about. And that's going to get worse as they become more desperate. As the planet becomes warmer, they're trying to keep the population from understanding fully what's been done to them, what's happening to the biosphere. And for your listeners, George, that doubt or question that such extreme climate engineering can be done, they should search Chinese scientists create artificial snowstorm. They'll find Fox News and Popular Science covered that. They can look for themselves.
I'm told that all around the planet, there's a massive die-off of trees. And Do you think that's happening and it's part of this geoengineering?
Well, first, any form of human activity that alters the energy balance of the planet or contaminates the biosphere is a form of geoengineering. We need to consider that.
Okay.
But, that being said, the intentional effort to manipulate the climate, the most catastrophic of all. Let's put the tree factor into mathematical terms. Globally, we have lost, since the dawn of civilization, over 3.4 trillion trees. That's 55% of the original tree cover. The 45% that's left is sick and dying. No trees, no people. That's very simple. In regard to the tree die-off, mathematically speaking, and this is where academia has betrayed the entire human race by denying the climate engineering issue and for countless reasons. But in regard to the tree die-off, climate engineering, mathematically, is the greatest single factor. Why? It's destroying the ozone layer. And George, have you seen in the last few days headlines from various sources that are saying someone somewhere is producing ozone-destroying chemicals? Have you seen those headlines?
I've heard of that, yeah.
So we went from 5 months ago saying the ozone layer is recovering, which we knew was a lie. We posted on this at geoengineeringwatch.org. I think we were the first that I know of to post UV data stating how radically high the UV radiation was. It's hitting us, not just UV A and B, but UVC. So all through these last 5-6 years, while we've put out this information, finally we got some confirmation that yes, the ozone layer is, in fact, not recovering. And now we get this scapegoat story that someone somewhere is producing ozone-destroying chemicals. It's climate engineering. So back to the trees dying, climate engineering being the single greatest source, not the only source. I want to stress that. We have a lot of forms of human damage. But the intense UV is literally frying the foliage. It has an incredibly detrimental effect on all vegetation. We have the toxic metals I already talked about raining down through the precipitation. We know from peer-reviewed study how toxic those materials are to root systems, so it's killing the trees from the bottom up. We have a disrupted hydrological cycle, the rain cycle, so we have immense drought. And we have lowering atmospheric relative humidities, and you cannot have that on a warming planet without geoengineering. It's not possible based on the laws of physics. So we have this flash drought. Have you heard the term flash drought, George?
I have not.
That's a new term. We didn't have flash drought. If we go back 2+ decades, we didn't have flash drought.
Hold on for a second, Dane. We're at the break. We're going to come back and talk more about geoengineering. Next hour, we'll take phone calls with you right here on Coast to Coast AM.
The free Coast Zone email newsletter is sent out 6 days a week and is a great way to keep up.